Hello, World Wide Web. Welcome back to the Hangin With Web Show. I'm GW Pomichter. Thank you so much for logging on or tuning in or clicking over. They do all the social media stuff. Yeah. I have no idea how they got here. All I know is when they get here, they wonder, how did I get to this part of town?
That's right.
So they're here, and we hope you'll stay, and we hope you hit subscribe so you can come back over and over again. We got artists, authors, filmmakers, musicians, creative minds of all kinds. We are at Indie Bookfest 2019 in Orlando, Florida, and we're hanging out right now with author Josh Zepess, the author of Slap Yourself. Wait for it. I actually did say Slap Yourself. I wasn't talking to you. Stop slapping yourself. This guy.
Unless you want to.
If you want, I mean, yeah.
Yeah, it's all right.
And the problem is that we've spent probably, they've been watching for about 3 weeks now since Indie Bookfest.
Okay.
And they've heard from so many different kinds of authors that at this point they don't know how to take the slap yourself. Because they've heard from all kinds. You've been in that room.
I have. It's been amazing.
It can go all different ways now.
The level of creativity is incredible.
Isn't it, though? I mean, incredible. Just amazing. Josh, thanks for coming and hanging out
with us
today,
man. Absolutely. My pleasure.
All right. Well, let's talk about slap yourself first.
Yes.
Nobody says that line ever. So he's like, okay. Tell us, where did this come from? What was broken that day?
I think what happened was I escaped from corporate America.
Mm-hmm.
And what I do is help other people escape. And I decided to write a book about the wake-up call. What does it take to get out of that comfort zone, out of corporate America?
We are creatures of conditioning.
Yes, we are.
And a lot of times, and we actually talk about this, especially with our creative audience here, that people tend to get into this rut, like right after high school, mm-hmm. college, where they dive into what they think of as life, adulting. I heard them say it.
Yes. Okay?
Which is basically work and pay. Work and pay.
I didn't know that was a verb, by the way. That's a new verb.
Adulting.
Adulting.
Yes. Like. And as they do it, I kind of as we get older, we realize that we're watching them do, we did it too.
Sure.
And
sure.
We were watching them do this, and it's, they go to work, they get a check, they write a bunch of checks to other people, and then they go back to work the next week.
Yeah,
and
so they can write more checks.
And that's just a rut. Work and pay, work and pay. It's like you're a cog in a wheel.
They call it the rat race.
For a reason.
Have you heard about the joke about the rat race?
No.
Even if you win, you're still just a rat.
True. Very true. And so you managed to just say, that's it, I'm done.
That's it.
I'm gonna get off the rat race, I'm gonna get out of the wheel.
That's right. I had a couple of wake up calls, mm-hmm. and that's what propelled me out, and that's where the book idea came from is, well, what are the questions? So slap yourself is the 12 most important questions you've never asked yourself and how the answers can save your life. And those are the questions you should ask yourself if you do want to get out of the rat race. These are the initial set of questions.
That's fantastic. A lot of self-reflection going on there.
A lot of self-reflection going on there.
So we don't want to give away too much of the book. They have to actually go to Amazon and pay money for that. Now, but we do want to give them a little. Let's give them a little taste. What is the single most important one of those 12 questions that you?
Ooh, that's a tough one.
Where do you start?
That's a tough one. So I'll tell you where I start.
Yeah.
I start with, what do you want from life?
Okay.
What do you want to be? What do you want to do? And what do you want to have? I speak to a lot of kids out in schools about money. That's one of my expertise. And I always ask them, I say, why did you wake up this morning? Why are you here? Why do you exist? No answers. No idea. No purpose. No, what do you want from life? They can't answer it. So that's why I put that as the first question, because if you don't know where you're going, every road will take you nowhere. And that's Henry Kissinger said that.
I love that. Yeah. Because it really does speak to us, especially as we are becoming young adults.
Right.
Today, so much of who we are, or who we define ourselves as, mm-hmm. is coming from a place of, what do you want to do? Not what do you want.
Correct.
What do you want to do?
Yeah.
They start this in about junior high now. My older boys are like 30 years old, but I remember them being in junior high and coming home with this little questionnaire. Uh-huh. Like they were going to fill this, what do you want to be when you grow up?
Yeah.
And all I could remember is when we were kids, the idea of what do we, I have no idea.
No.
Rich, famous, success, whatever. There were a lot of adjectives that we could use, but not any
Correct.
Nouns, because who knows when you're 14?
Right.
But they had these kids kind of defining themselves by what they wanted to do rather than what they wanted to be.
How about, where do you want to be?
That's another great question.
Because then you can say, is what I'm doing today going to get me there? And if the answer is no, change what you're doing. But the problem is we get stuck just doing. It's like being on a treadmill.
Yeah.
Man, we're sweaty, we're expending a lot of energy, we're tired, we're like, man, I'm busy. I'm super busy, but we're on the treadmill, we're going nowhere.
And I'm the first one to tell people, especially young people,
yeah,
the world needs everything. It
absolutely
needs plumbers, yes, and it needs electricians, and it needs guys who do paving on the roads, and it needs all of these things. But the guys who have always done those things best are the guys who, for whatever reason, had a passion, had a dream that they did it for. The plumbers, guys, I know it doesn't sound like a sexy job to the masses, but somebody created that stuff. Somebody understands the function and importance of bringing water into your house and taking it out of your house.
Yep.
And that guy that understands it, that has a mind for it.
That's right.
Don't discourage, don't tell him to go to med school.
Correct.
Because he needs to go where his passion and his drive is.
And you just said question number four, by the way, which is, if you were paid in happiness, what would you do?
I love that.
So,
that's
happiness
awesome.
Is now the national currency. No more money. The happier you are doing what you're doing, the more wealthy you are in society. What would you be doing? That's one of my challenge questions.
That's fantastic.
And then how do you monetize it?
So the one a great mentor of mine when I was very young once told me the line that he used was the luckiest, most fortunate person in the world is the person who finds their dream, their passion, and then finds someone to pay them for it.
Exactly.
And as a young person, I thought that person was crazy because
well,
we all
course.
Do. We look at our dads and our mentors and other people, and you're like, "Ah, you guys are crazy." And then as you get older, you realize that's the most true statement in the world, because so many people get caught in the rut of the rat race, and they get caught in the rhythm and routine of simply doing without thinking anymore.
Yep.
And so your company that is you're helping people to do this, to find that balance between dream and reality.
Yes.
Broke is no joke.
Correct.
Where did this come from? What happened? Where did you?
This actually
now,
came
from breaking out of corporate America yourself and saying, okay, I'm out.
Yeah.
I'm out of the rat race. I'm living my dream, whatever that is.
Correct.
You took it to the next level, though. Let's help other people.
I did.
Do this
I knew,
too. Why?
Exactly. It was a calling. I spent 20 years as a semiconductor engineer thinking I was doing the right thing. And then I got a wake-up call one day, and then another wake-up call, and another one. I said, I can't keep doing this. This isn't going to work. So the biggest wake-up call, honestly, was my 401k was not going to work. And I don't know if you know what it feels like to do something for 18 years, being 100% sure it was going to work, and then you find out it's not going to.
Yeah, the
something as important as your future, your retirement. And then I found out it wasn't supposed to work. And that really just pissed me off, honestly.
Yeah, well, for those of you guys are a little younger and you don't realize, because now everybody's got a 401k, everybody's got
it's still
IRAs
it's a
or whatever.
It is.
Years ago, in a building nation, in a nation that was determined to be the next step, they had what was called a guaranteed retirement.
Called pensions.
You put in, you put in 20, 25, even 30 years sometimes. Yeah. So you put in the time.
Right.
And then you retired comfortably, knowing that 30 years of accomplishment was whatever. Now, it became, at first it made us all feel better because we were now going to be market players.
That's right.
If we joined in 401k, no longer was I limited to my employer's ability to make money into my future. Mm-hmm. Now, I was part of the greater marketplace. Sounds great.
Yes.
But being rich is a risk. And every rich person out there can tell you when they start moving money around the market, there are no guarantees.
No, absolutely not.
So we sign up for 401k, we become one of them.
Correct.
And we don't have the kind of money they do.
And we also don't have the knowledge. We're not investors.
No.
We're plumbers, we're electricians, we're engineers. We're not investors, but now we're expected to become investors. Otherwise, we're screwed.
That's right. When we get to the end of the road, we realize we may, and we're still making decisions that we're not qualified for.
Right.
When you're engineering something, you're qualified to engineer something.
Right.
When you look at the market, you're trying to engineer your future, and you're not qualified to work with the mechanics of the market. So someone says to you, "Okay, well, I'm your guy. Tell me where to put your money."
Right.
And how are we supposed to know where to put our money? Like you said, you engineer things, or you are a plumber, or a doctor, or a lawyer, whatever. You're not a money guy. So you tell me where to put my money, not the other way around.
Exactly.
Otherwise, you find out way later in life. I've got 20 years poured into this thing.
Yep.
And thanks to, I remember We're just old enough to remember Red October.
Of course. Oh, yeah.
When everybody in the 401k market all of a sudden got that phone call saying, hey, remember how you were steady growing at 12% annually?
Yep.
You just took an 18% loss. And everybody went, well, I did what?
Well, in 2008, my 401k became a 201k. I lost half.
Oh,
literally,
my Lord.
Half was,
look at, see that?
I lost more money than most people will ever have in a 401k. And that's how crazy
insane.
It was. And that was unbelievable.
That, boom. And that now it's there. Now you have realized that
this
the rat race.
So you asked where Brokers No Joke came
from?
It's designed to expose the truth you're not supposed to know. Because I wasn't supposed to know my 401k isn't going to work. Most people out there still don't know how their 401k works, even though they're putting money into it. So it exposes the truth about relationships, money, life, entrepreneurship, the real, real stuff that we don't talk about at dinner tables. But someone's got to.
You do, and again, you know, I would say one of the interesting thing about the market in general right now is about 10 years ago, you and I started to see the advent of grandma starting to become a day trader through all these online websites and things like that. Now, she's only got about $500, so she's not going to hurt herself when she's day trading. However, enough grandmas and enough $500 checks now creates artificial demand. And
that's
then
true.
When they start selling, they create artificial, decline.
That's right.
And that artifice takes every person whose 401k is on the line and starts to play with it up and down in a way.
Yeah, we're all connected.
Yeah, artifice that we create by making grandma feel good because she's doing it herself. She feels like she's the next, Bill Gates because she's just doing all this stuff. Had no idea that she's affecting the retirement plans of her grandkids.
Yes.
And, I people who know me in the arts community know I tend to be a financial snob.
Okay.
I think people with money are best left to determine how money acts. People without it, we tend to screw things up a lot until we go out and learn.
Exactly, but
become
you would agree
educated.
we should learn the rules of the game.
Absolutely.
If you're
going to
play the game of life, which a big part is money,
shouldn't
you know the rules?
You should dedicate yourself to learning those
rules.
Because if you don't know the rules and you're just taking what you're being given as the rule, my dad used to say this in business. He used to say, never hire someone to do something you cannot do.
Right.
Hire people to do things you don't want to do.
Correct.
If you hire somebody to do something you cannot do, you'll never know if they're doing it right. And that's what people do with their money.
Yep.
You hire people to do stuff you can't do instead of things you don't want to do. I don't want to play
with
my money.
You're right.
I will hire an investor every day of the week, but I need to know if he's a good one or a bad one or if it's doing the right thing. And if I don't, I want to write. I want to do this show.
Exactly.
I want to do these things, right? You're doing webinars now. You're teaching this stuff. So. From the rat race to now, on that gauge of happiness, on that gauge of success, how are you doing?
Incredible.
Better?
In fact, people don't even believe it.
Really?
They ask how you're doing. I said, it's the best day I've ever had. It's absolutely incredible. And they're like, huh? I'm like, don't get too excited. That's like that every day.
Yeah.
It really is. I can't describe it. It can't be taught. It has to be caught.
I love that because you actually have to, people have to understand something. One of the things that we do as a species is we define our successes. We never think we do. We think dad did, or the teachers did, or the college did, our employers did, but how we feel about our success in life, we need to define that.
Correct.
Define it by
what
happiness, define it by money, define it by your house or your car, the girlfriend, whatever, but you define it. And if you don't take the time to define it and you let the world do that for you,
see, now you're talking about my favorite F word, freedom.
Awesome.
It's my favorite. It didn't used to be. In corporate America, I had a different favorite F word. I'll let you guess what that is. But right now, it's actually freedom, because freedom is control. Isn't it just doing what you want, when you want, how you want, why you want? You're defining your success?
Yeah, and you are happier when you define your success.
Absolutely. I'm happier when I'm in control,
because
when I define my success.
Because you can redefine your success at any time. And find happiness. You can say, I didn't make enough money today. But you know what? Did that make me less successful? No, I'm happier. I met great people. I did this today.
Right.
What's next for Broke
Broke is no joke. The next thing is building a movement.
Okay.
So I'm not going to change the world by myself, but I'm out to eradicate ignorance. I'm out to eradicate people not knowing what they're doing. I don't tell people what to do. I just want to make sure you know what you're doing. Because I believe if you have the right information, you'll make the right choice for yourself every single time.
He could just sit here and talk. I don't know if we're going to do the show forever. We're just going to sit here and talk some more. Because I remember, I tell people all the time, my favorite teacher growing up, and you and I think are around the same age, so we grew up during the Cold War.
Yes.
Teachers
that
used to tell us. Remember the horror stories the teachers used to tell you about what was going on in Russia? Uh-huh. And how those kids were told what they were going to be when they grew up, and you had freedom. And we didn't take that stuff very seriously. But I had a teacher once that told me, my job, names, dates, facts, figures, those things you're going to pick up.
Yeah.
My job is to teach you not what to learn, but how to learn.
Absolutely.
I'll never forget that line. I'll never forget that teacher, because if you learn how to learn, you'll never stop.
Correct.
You can't help yourself. You're thirsty. You want more.
Correct.
And that's what our generation, the generation coming up behind us, sometimes even our parents' generation, they need to be reminded of how to learn, how to go and find what they will define as happiness and success.
By the way, you're a money person, right? So you understand money a little bit.
I understand it. I don't have a lot of it, but I understand it.
That's okay. That's okay. We could change that.
And I understand how I don't have it, which is great, because I understand that.
So you can do something about it.
Yeah. By defining my level of success, I understand that I can choose to chase this dream, or take them in turn.
Yeah.
But I know enough to know that I can't go back into an office and chase that
dream.
There you
go. You're like me. You're unemployable, just like I am.
Absolutely.
Couldn't do it.
No, a few years ago, this became my day job. I interview authors, artists, filmmakers, poor people, and about success, about how to define your success.
Not poor, they just haven't realized their value yet.
And their potential, you know, because
they have a monetizer value, that's all.
And the truth is that I tell everybody in the arts community especially, look, realize that the artists whose names you know best, who have defined not a generation, but literally an era of the arts and entertainment industry.
Absolutely.
Those who probably never saw financial success during their lifetime. Their families are set for generations to come.
Absolutely, but they never
got to enjoy experience that because this is a career defined by what you're creating. And you there's no way to define it any other way. To find financial success, you have to walk a line. And when you do that, you become financially successful. But maybe 10 generations from now, they're going to look back and they're going to go, dude, I never have to work because great, 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 great grandpa wrote that book that one time.
That's right.
He probably never experienced that. Da Vinci spent a year on his back being paid by the church.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Not a good wage, but we'll never forget that. And if he had descendants, they wouldn't work.
So you're talking about my third favorite L word, legacy.
Awesome.
What is going to be your legacy?
Nice.
How's that for goal setting? Figure out what you want people to say about you. Write your eulogy. That's a challenge I do for people. Write your eulogy.
That's awesome. That's fantastic, man.
What do you want people to say about you? And then spend the rest of your life becoming the person worthy of that eulogy. How could that not be a good life? How can that not be a fulfilled life? And the money will be there. Money's just the effect of stuff. Don't worry. Don't do anything.
She's going to flash that card because
she
could do this for a while. She's like, hey,
case.
Guys, all right.
We're having too much fun.
Guys, we're going to say thank you to our partners and friends over at Famous Faces of Funny. Rick Shane and his team over there, amazing comic shop, a place to get your nerd on, baby. Go and get anything you need. Space Coast Comics, Indie Originals, Josh Bauer at J. Bauer Art. This art on our set is amazing.
That's
it's
awesome.
All original artwork from J. Bauer Art. Our great friends at the Foxwood Wine Company, because these chairs are really comfy and nicer to do interviews in than those folding chairs. And Hearts Helping Others of Central Florida. Bea and her crew over there are helping families throughout Central Florida to reach the next level, whether it's kids at Christmas time or helping folks out all around the community. It's awesome. Thank you for all you guys do. Thank you for sharing our videos and our creative artists all over the World Wide Web. We've been hanging out with Josh Zepess, the author of Slap Yourself, the owner of Broke Is No Joke. So check him out online. We're going to drop links in the description down below so you can find him and do all kinds of research and learn what he's got to say, guys, because this has been the most interesting conversation I think I've had in months. It's just amazing to see somebody who's set on a journey to make other people's lives better.
And we just scratched the surface. We haven't even gotten started yet, man.
15 minutes is not enough, guys. No. She cheated. She cuts us off.
Oh, that's right.
Guys, subscribe, log on, tune in, and see who we're hanging with next.